truth is that he told my speech, actually. He told everything I wanted to tell you in a little bit I don't know very good English, so I, if I forget what I have to say, I will read it. I don't have a fancy PowerPoint presentation, but I have those, and I can read from this if I forget. The truth is that the whole day I was fighting with this feeling that I want to flee, because to run away. Because I asked myself how I ended up with such serious people on such a serious event, people who really do serious things, build buildings, and who had serious studies and stuff like that. But the girl who invited me told me, in your films and in your theater plays, there is a personal approach, and I have the feeling that there is innovation in this, to be personal like you. And I was thinking about why I do this, why I work so personal, and I realized that this is only a tool telling stories which are very universal and which have actually nothing to do with me as a person. Because stories and life stories have the same formula in every life, in every movie, in every theater play. The hero's journey is a common formula. This is the part of the speech I improvise now. because I was thinking about this during the day. And the hero is not like Che Guevara. The hero is simply the person who is thrown into life and have to deal with unknown, with the unknown, with circumstances. Everybody's a hero to grow up, to get older, to marry. And this is the hero's journey. It can be a hero's journey to have to fix a car or something like that. And this part of the journey I wanted to tell about, it began by the fact that I was hating school. I felt such a deep boredom that I just stopped going there when I was in the 10th grade. And this is a very common problem. Many children hate to go to school and they think that this is normal, but I'm sure it's not. And at the time of communism, it was even worse. We had even more stuff, useless stuff we had to learn. So I had the feeling, it was my survival instinct, that I better don't go there because I will lose some very important parts of my life, like freedom and creativity and the hope that a human being can ever find something in life what he really likes. And many colleagues of mine did the same thing. We were hanging out in empty flats, going to in parks, reading books, smoking. But each of them went back to school in the right moment to write a test, to get a note, to graduate, and in order to go to study. And it was actually the only behavior that seemed to have sense. But I didn't do it, so I was expelled from the school, and this in a small town, as a girl, being expelled from the best school, and everybody know each other, it was like being an alien. And this was a very, very precious experience for me, because I realized that I can stand this, and I felt some kind of strength. I felt my inner strength, and I think that if you really want to change something in your life or in your mind, you have to be able to cope with loneliness, with exclusion, and with very serious doubt about that you are maybe mad, that you are going to ruin your life. You have to face darkness if you really want to change something in your life, or if you want to provoke change in society. I had the feeling that was everything all right, but I had no logical explanation why. And later the revolution came, and I went to study literature in Cluj, and the same feeling overcame me that that I was bored and I lost interest. And then I started to ask myself, maybe I am the problem. Maybe I am simply a person who cannot stand daily routine, and you have to flee all the time. And this was right. It was a big problem with me. And there I have another point there, that your problems and your neurosis and your craziness, or simply your pain, is the source of any change. And or the need behind your mode is the engine. What pushes the story on? So at that time, I started to walk around with a world map, dreaming about South America and Asia and India. My mother earned as a university professor like 100 Deutschmark in a month, and the ticket to India was like 600. So it was a matter of impossibility to get there. But I quit my studies and I went to Budapest, where my father was living as a refugee. And I started again studies, quit them, and then my father told me, "What do you want to do? Because I know a lot you don't want to." And I told him, "I want to travel. I want to know more countries, more cultures. I want to get out of this very closed environment I was grown up in, because TEDxTârguMureș was, or the whole country, was very suffocating at that time." And he told me, "Forget about, for that you must have been born rich or in another country, or go and study foreign affairs, go and work in diplomacy, and then maybe in some years or when you get old, you can go to Asia." And I told him, "Nah, but I want to go now, and I will show you that this is possible." And some months later, a German friend called me. I met her by chance, by a scholarship in Bonn, and told me, "Look, I'm working in a Chinese circus. It's very nice there. Come and visit me." So I went there. She was working there as a dresser, and in the same day, I was asked if I want to stay and work as a popcorn seller. And I happily said yes, because I earned in one day more than my mother in a month. And it was a very funny and easy job. I was surrounded by quite free people. Circus people are nomads and are very different to small town bourgeois I got to know till then. And it was a great mind opener for me to stay there. But my parents and my friends got even more desperate. "What is she doing in the Chinese circus with 21 years? You should get serious and you should settle down." And at that time, this kind of life, traveling around and doing different jobs, was completely alien. It was a very clear program: study, marriage, work. And even now, children or the parents of the children are thinking very early at the career, and you have to go also in this town, in these elite classes, and be a very good student, and do sports, and do music, and go in the political parties, youth organization, and do everything right, win every competition. But my story is about what happens to you if you do everything wrong. If you are literally the worst student in your class, if you lose every competition, if you do nothing for your career, you just only follow your moods or your inner call, but you don't know in that moment if the voice you are receiving is your inner call or it's the sound of self-destruction. But one thing surely happened to you, you will have a very exciting life full of adventures. And it's true you cannot put those on your CV. And you might have a lot of holes in it, a lot of years you cannot account for. Studying between 1990 and 2006 or something like that, a long period. What did you do all the time? I believe. So, some weeks ago, a young girl asked me, what did you do for a half a year in India? Because I'm thinking about to go there to find a scholarship, an internship to work. And I told her, oh, it's almost finished, my time. Okay. And I told her, I was just traveling. And she looked at me astonished. Just being there 6 months without any goal, and I say, yes, I was there 6 months without any goal, and it was a very nice experience. It was like an initiation in a magic of life without goals and without reasons, and just being in the moment. And this not like a Hinduist dogma, but as a life experience. And yes, it is very frightening to go without any security for such a long time. But let's go on with the story. So after some months in the circus, I was able to buy a ticket to India, and I made a photocopy of it and sent it to my father with the sentence, this is a very slow time, with the sentence, you see it's possible. And then I quit it with my boyfriend. I had with him a very scandalous relationship. And I took a flight from Frankfurt to Bombay with my German friend. And yes, I arrived in India. Like, yeah, I was 21 years old then. And the first thing, when the plane stopped and I got out from the plane, this smell of India hit me. It is a very wet, smoky smell. I never experienced in Europe, not even in the regional train via Razboen in the 80s. And then, this was just the beginning, because these kind of shocks were just one after each other, and I went into a state of panic. And I remained in this state of panic for weeks. The only reason why I didn't come back immediately was my pride, because I would think, okay, you left school, you left university, and you cannot even take your own adventure, this is too much. Now you have to resist. And you have to know at that time, no internet, no mobile phone, television, no cheap traveling, no cheap flights. It was very complicated to travel. And I know India from books, not from images. So even the image was very hard to take. I wasn't prepared for that at all. And after 4 weeks of panic, suddenly, a feeling of security came, of safety, and this feeling that something invisible is there and helping me. And I wasn't believing in God, but the simple fact that in India you are at mercy of luck all the time, because there are some timetables for train and bus, but it is a question of luck if your bus or your train is ever arriving, or it's a question of luck if the rickshaw driver will take you to the place, or the cow in the middle of the street chewing paper will not gore you, or it's a question of luck to get don't get food poisoned or robbed or stuff like that. But you can have, you can be unlucky too, or it's a question of luck to cross a road alive. And I realized then that luck somehow depends on my state of mind. When I got stressed and angry about this chaotic, dirty, rotten country, all my experiences mirrored that to me. And then the rickshaw driver would took me somewhere completely else, and I get robbed, and I get have food poisoning, and even the cow beat me up, you know? And this in one day only. So it was like a survival instinct that I started to deal with states of mind and with hazard. And I built a relationship to that. And this was the most important experience for me, actually. And for this, it was very important that I had no goal, because I think in life it's always like this, that hazard and fate and luck have a huge role in our lives. This is just not visible behind daily routine. And if you go up, if you get off the beaten path, then you let hazard come into your life. If you get off the beaten path, then other forces take over. Then it's not enough anymore to be well organized and be practical and material. And this is not enough under normal circumstances either, but it's not so obvious. And if you let control, then the metaphysical dimension of life kicks in instantly. And this is there all the time, but we cannot recognize it. So I think getting off the beaten path is a very, very basic, good school for everyone. You can learn some basic things about life, which can be very useful even if you are working afterwards in a bank or in a bakery, or if you come to lead a country. It is the fact that our decisions are not completely our own, and we have to make friends with hazard and with fate. Or to put it in other terms, you have to make friends with your unconscious or with the collective unconscious, because you cannot arrive anything in life, in your own life or in the society, if you don't have these forces on your side. And you can name it as you like, because, yes, you don't have to name it God, but you can name it hazard, or you can name it fate, or maybe you are comfortable with the term of unconscious. This is the most scientific one. Okay, the last part, time died. After some months in India, I was alone because my friend already went back to Germany. I went to Madras and I checked in a hotel, and they was looking, there was a board behind the receptionist's desk, and I was searching for a concert, because Madras is the center of Indian classical music. And they were looking like this, and I saw a small piece of paper with my name on it, Réka. And I was thinking, who knows that I'm here? Nobody. Who knows that I'm here? Nobody. So maybe I have jungle fever or something, or a very serious condition. And I took it out, and it was written on it, I'm at Mahabalipuram by Mrs. Raja Lakshmi's, without signature, in Hungarian. And I was like, okay. And then an English guy helped me because I was in shock. Okay, just translate. What is there? What is written there? I'm in Mahabalipuram. Okay, Mahabalipuram is a small village, 3 hours away from here. Go there and check. What is it? I went there, and there I found my ex-boyfriend. I left in Hungary. He came to find me in India because he wanted to talk some things over. But he didn't know where I am. He just went to places where I sent postcards from, but he didn't find a trace of me, of course. And then he started to show my picture in trains. People thought to him, hey, do you know where you are? Do you know how big this country is? Do you know how many people are living here? You are in India! And then he went to take a bath in the ocean, and a huge wave came and just hit him down. And then he was forced to spend some days in bed. And then he had a genius idea. He told himself, okay, then let's hazard, decide what will happen. And he just opened the traveler's guide at random, and it opened by Mahabalipuram, which is a small village on the seaside. He went there. He went to the next big town, which was Madras, and he put it one message, one hotel, one. And the next day, I went there by chance and took this paper off. This is about hazard.